I'm the real Spider-Man.
No, I am the real Spider-Man.
Guys, guys, we're all the real Spider-Man.
Guys, welcome back to the channel. Oh my gosh, guys. Oh my gosh, this movie is insane. How is it possible that a movie can have this many creative styles? How is it even possible that this movie exists? Okay, there's just so much to talk about here. Before I begin, we will be getting into deep spoiler territory here, so if you don't want to be spoiled, click off now. Okay, let's start with the most striking factor, which is the animation. The very beginning of the movie starts off with a bang, literally. We're caught up with Gwen Stacy, aka Spider-Woman, and what's going on in her life. I really like how her world is all watercolors and soft pastels. Every single dimension has a different art style and themes. Like Mumbatan, which is a combination of Mumbai and Manhattan. It's drawn in this really cool ultra comic style. There's also Nueva York, which is like a super futuristic New York, and the colors are really sharp there. They even brought in a Lego dimension, which I thought was a cool little nod to Lord and Miller, who directed this movie and also directed the Lego movie. Every shot is meant to advance the story. There's no filler, no random subplots. Everything is focused on working through the main plotline. I never got bored once during this movie. The shots are just so alive. You can have one art style in one shot, and then it switches to a completely different art style to match the mood in the next shot. It kept my eyes glued to the screen. See, that's what we call environmental storytelling. Disney, take notes. Honestly, Disney really dug themselves in the grave by releasing Elemental right after Spider-Verse. You think people are gonna want to see this generic played out plot after watching Spider-Verse? There's no competition here. Wait, what were we talking about again? Oh right, the cinematography. When I first went into this film, I was expecting it to just be a copy-paste of Spider-Verse regarding the animation style. Oh man, was I wrong. I didn't expect them to be able to make it even more creative and unique than the first film. I mean, the Italian Renaissance villain from the very beginning of the movie is just so cool. I love how they blended this sepia, classic hand-drawn vulture into the futuristic 3D animation of the present world. The whole movie is eye candy, honestly. Let's talk about the story, though. The story is so original and unique. There's no cliches and no played-out plotline. It keeps your focus on Miles and his adventure. The story just has so much meat to it and so much to dig your teeth into. Miles' character arc is so strong and well-developed. Though it was cut off during the end of the movie because we got the cliffhanger ending, I really want to see him overcome the fact that he's an anomaly and show that he does belong with the other Spider-Mans, even though he was never meant to be one. I also hope in the next movie they make Gwen and Miles' reunion really meaningful and that they can make up well. I know it sounds weird, but the current movie does a really good job of slowly breaking their friendship as they lose trust in one another. In the beginning of the movie, when Gwen visits Miles, you could almost say a romance was budding. But then that all got thrown down the drain because Gwen hid stuff behind Miles' back. It was in concern for his safety, but it ended up doing more damage than good. I love how they were able to tie in a lot of stuff to the first movie. Like the spider that bit Miles? They thought about it from the very beginning, because in the first movie, when you first see the spider, it's glitching, because it's from another dimension. It also has the number 42 on it. And what I consider to be the greatest tie-in of all is the fact that the villain of the whole film is the guy that got hit with the bagel in Into the Spider-Verse. I call it the bagel effect. Like, how funny is it that a minor joke from the first film became an actual identifiable factor for Spot in the second film? Because everybody remembers the guy that got hit with the bagel in the first movie. That just shows you how great of a sequel Across the Spider-Verse is. I mean, bagels have holes, and the Spot's superpower is opening dimension holes. Coincidence? I think not! Anyway, yeah, the movie does a very good job of connecting to the last film and making it feel like a fluent continuation after the conclusion of Into the Spider-Verse. And oh my gosh, when Miles ended up in the wrong world because the spider he bit is from the wrong dimension and he sees himself as the Prowler, I guess you could say it subverted my expectations, which is something very few movies successfully accomplish. It's just so smart. By him not even supposing to exist as Spider-Man, he sees what his world could have become, and what he could have become. I can't wait to see Miles fight the evil variant of himself in the next movie. Oh yeah, I mentioned a character called The Spot earlier. There are two villains in this movie, The Spot and Miguel O'Hara, the latter being not so much a villain, but a conflicted character. It's not like Miguel has bad intentions. In fact, his intentions are set on saving the other universes and making sure Miles doesn't mess that up, since Miles is an anomaly. His problem is that he's blinded by hate and grief. He also made things worse by messing with the canon, which, by the way, we're entering into Spider-Man lore here. I've never heard an animated movie refer to itself with the word canon. That's usually a fan thing. Pretty cool, though. Back to Miguel, I think he's a really good character. I just wish I could have seen maybe a little more of his arc, since it was turning out really well. I can't wait to see the conclusion for his arc in the next movie, where Miles will probably prove him wrong by showing that Spider-Man can save both worlds. But can we just talk about the best villain in this movie, which is the Spot? The Spot is such an excellent villain. Not only is his design just so cool, but I love how they made him a pathetic loser that is only there for comedy into someone that is genuinely menacing and has mastered his powers. He's so powerful that he can go up against four Spider-Mans at once. It's like the usual superhero arc, but reversed. It's just so fun and also incredibly chilling whenever this guy is on screen. If there was the smallest iota of a complaint I could make for this movie, it's the fact that the Spot disappears for like half the film. Why not have him attack Miles through his mind throughout the movie like he did when he showed Miles that his dad was going to die? It would have helped remind the audience that the Spot is still a lurking threat despite him not being on screen. It also would have added to the urgency of Miles trying to get back to his father in time to save him. Kind of like how Puss in Boots: The Last Wish had Death constantly reappearing to Puss. I know the Spot only disappears because the movie's focus is on Miguel, not him, but still, I kind of wanted to see more of the Spot. I'm scrounging here, guys. I really can't find anything wrong with this movie. It's literally just that. And maybe a couple little nitpicks, but they're mostly just a me thing. Like, for example, it was really hard to hear what punk rock Spider-Man was saying, especially in the movie theater. It didn't obstruct me from understanding what was happening in the story. I probably just missed a couple of jokes. That'll be fixed when the movie comes out and we get subtitles, though. Can we talk about the soundtrack for a minute? Like, how is it this good? I'm talking about the instrumental here. The music can range from super inspiring and make you sit in jaw-dropped silence as you watch the scene unfold, or make you stiffly lean back into your chair when it becomes sinister and spine-chilling. Like at the end of the movie where Miles is trying to make it to his house in time to save his dad and the music is swelling and the shots keep going back to Gwen as she tries to find him in her own dimension, and then later when Miles is confronted by himself as the Prowler, I got chills. I didn't know that they could make a theme scarier than the Prowler's theme in this movie. The Spot's theme is absolutely chilling. I was clenching the armrests of my seat when I heard it. The Spot's theme actually made me feel disturbed. That's incredible. It's so eerie and fitting when you see his backstory drawn in that clean sketchbook style. I officially declare him to have the scariest animated villain theme of all time. There's your gold star. I lost my mind when it turned out that this is only the second part of a Spider-Verse trilogy. I thought that we were only getting a sequel. Nothing makes me happier to hear that there's gonna be another Spider-Verse movie. The only problem is waiting 8 months for it to get here, which might tone down the hype, but still. The only thing I can think about is just how amazing Beyond the Spider-Verse is going to be. I have no idea how they're gonna top this film with the third one. Remember how I said in my How to Train Your Dragon video that I consider the HTTYD movies to be the greatest animated trilogy of all time? Well, never mind. Sorry, but the Spider-Verse trilogy takes the cake. I still think the How to Train Your Dragon movies are amazing, don't get me wrong, but Spider-Verse is just on a whole other level of creativity and art. This movie proves that adults can watch animated films and get worth out of them. Animation doesn't necessarily have to be a kid thing. This movie felt like a real Spider-Man movie translated into animation. It retained all of those amazing values from live-action film and implemented them into the story of Spider-Verse. I'm just so excited for Beyond the Spider-Verse, where we'll see the epic conclusion to the story of Miles Morales and the rest of the Spider-Crew. It's going to be amazing. This is Isabella Iggyfeather, signing out. Thanks for watching!